originally from Maine, so I'm headed toward the Midwest, and it was my first foray down into Kansas, besides Kansas City, where the Lego was. today what I'm going to be talking about is 3D GIS. And I'd like to situate, before I jump into talking about some of the digital tools that we've been creating, which is a lot of what I'll be talking about today, I want to step back and really sort of focus on a little bit and set the stage by talking about the reasons behind developing these tools, where they came from, to some extent. And as Bill mentioned, this is a collaborative project, so I'm going to be talking about collaborative work that I've done, but I'm also going to speak to it somewhat from my perspective and the questions that I, and my role that comes through into the projects. So I'm a landscape archaeologist, and the things that I'm really interested in are sort of these general questions of how does the organization of a landscape influence where people go, what they do, whom interacts with whom, and how does this shape their experiences? To do this specifically, I've been interested in a couple of cultural mechanisms, accessibility and invisibility. I'm interested in how those two mechanisms, how objects within the landscape influence where people go, right? And what they see, how that influences how they interact and their experiences on a primordial basis, not necessarily only for ritual events, partially as well. And the area of the world that I am focusing on addressing this question is the ancient Maya region. So for some of you who may not be familiar with this area, it comprises a large part of Mexico and much of Central America, defined by these hash lines here. And the Maya civilization really comes to be a distinct kind of group around 1000 BC. However, often when we think of the Maya, we think of these large temples, this elaborate architecture, astronomy, and writing. And a lot of that comes from a little bit later, the classic period, from around the 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th centuries. And so what I've been interested in is looking in this area at these questions of accessibility and visibility. The area that I specifically do a lot of my case study work, along with the projects that I'll be talking about, is Copan, which is here in the periphery, the southeast periphery of the Maya region, which I won't talk about today, but brings up a lot of interesting questions about sort of being this frontier border zone area with different cultural interactions, and sort of how people within a landscape like this might be interacting differently than, say, perhaps Maya sites in other areas. The site today is a UNESCO World Heritage Site as well. So what do we know about, I'm interested in trying to understand interaction on the landscape, trying to, through that interaction, understand some of the social structure of the ancient Maya. What do we know about them? Well, in some sense, we, from the archaeological evidence, from the distribution of luxury goods, the distribution of elaborate versus non-elaborate architecture, through access to various food sources, we know that, and through iconography and imagery and hieroglyphs, we know that there was a royal elite in the classic time period. We have rulers and kings, and then we have lesser non-royal elite. And then the majority of the population was really non-elite, right? Or sometimes we refer to them as commoners. And so we have this generalized diagram of Maya social structure. And what I want to do is be able to, within these areas, kind of understand how people were living and experiencing things on a daily basis. Looking at accessibility and visibility. So, the way that I approached this, I started doing this for my dissertation, and so I started doing this primarily from a GIS, a geographic information systems approach. And so what that allowed me to do was take data that had to give it locational precision and then overlay various data sets, whether it be hydrology, soil, archaeological structures, and then analyze and complex spatial patterns with those data. But I found that while this was really useful, and I still use GIS, particularly for the quantitative aspects of it, I was interested in trying to get an experience in the past. And to do that with a flat, whether it's an interactive map or not, you're missing a lot of what about human perception, right? The sense of mass, the sense of scale, the sense of movement through this landscape. And so so I began to turn to 3D visualization in addition to GIS. So the two main aspects, what I'm going to talk about today, and where this has come from, is the Maya Arc 3D project, which is a large interdisciplinary international project, which has really been focused on bringing together 3D and GIS into common tools that allow us to address humanities questions in the digital realm in ways that we can't do without those digital tools. And then more recently, I've begun the Maya City Builder Project since I've started at UNL, and I'll talk about how that complements this and builds off of the Maya Arc 3D project, which is still ongoing. So I wanted to just give you a little bit of history about the Maya Arc 3D project. It was officially begun in 2009. It was co-founded by myself and an art historian, Dr. Jennifer von Schwerin. And we were talking about one day, you know, she was actually my advisor on my doctoral committee. And, you know, we were sitting there talking about things, and I was interested in this landscape perspective, trying to understand where people were going and what they were seeing and how this was influencing them and how the landscape influenced things. And using GIS to do this. And she, you know, and then to understand social political relationships through this understanding of this movement through the landscape and what they were seeing. She was trying to understand and reconstruct the social political structure by using 3D modeling software, 3D Studio Max, to reconstruct an 8th century temple. And then situated more or less in her mind within the broader context of the city, right? Not within, and trying to understand its relationship. So we said, wouldn't it be really great if we had this system that did both, right? It allowed it to have the power of a GIS, but we're working in this 3D world. It brings our two things together. And so we applied for a NEH Digital Humanities Startup Grant, and we received this one. And so in phase one, we had planning workshops. We held two. We held one in Honduras, which we had about 80 participants. Our goal for this was to be able to bring in, we've brought in some researchers from Europe as well as from the US who focus on Maya and Honduran archaeology. But a bigger part of that was we wanted local Hondurans to be involved. We wanted to know what they wanted, what they needed. So we brought in a lot of cultural resource managers from the Institute of Anthropology and History. We also brought in local educators from high school and the university. We sat around, and for 2 days we had some technical specialists sort of show, at the time, the cutting edge work they had been doing in cultural heritage with 3D modeling and GIS. And then we had roundtable discussions on, okay, given these capabilities, what is it that you see that you might need or not need? And so from that, we then went on and held a second workshop in Zurich, where it was a smaller one with a technology specialist, and said, okay, given these needs that we've prioritized, what can we do? So then we put in for a second grant. So we were able to get an NEH Digital Humanities Startup Grant for phase two. And in this one, the goal of this one was to be able to implement sort of some of those key technological things we had discovered and talked about in the first phase. So we developed a pipeline and a prototype tool called Query Arc 3D, which allowed us to, it was the basic infrastructure of a 3D tool that you could move around, navigate, click on structures, and bring up information that was linked to a database. We also beta tested this at a few universities in the U.S. as well as some in Europe, and we had a laundry list of things that, you know, students and faculty really enjoyed the tool. They saw the relevance for it, but there were also shortcomings. And a lot of this was based off of, you know, a limited amount of funding. And a little bit of time that we had. So we were able to begin phase three with funding from the German Ministry of Federal Ministry of Research and Education, the BMBF, out of Germany. And we began a 3-year project, and then we've just finished that in July. There were three main components to this. Okay, one was data acquisition. The original database, quite frankly, was from my GIS. It was focused on certain questions I had been, and it was very, very small. So we really needed more data in this tool. It's hard to have someone evaluate, use it without data in it, right? So we began to acquire new data. Some of that was photogrammetric data, where we take photos in the field to create 3D models. Some of that was laser scanning to do that as well. You can see a laser scanner here, which allows you to capture 3D points and then create 3D models. But a lot of this was also going into the archives at the lab in Honduras and pulling out legacy data. Scanning that data for them is a form of archival documents, because a lot of these are just, they're in a climate-controlled environment, but they're deteriorating. And then translating those into the database. The second thing is expanding that database. It was very, very small. It was a few relational tables put together in a Postgres SQL database, open source database. So what we did was spent a lot of time revamping it, creating a lot more tables, and setting up the links so that we would have the structure there. The ones highlighted here are the ones that we actually have data in. So we still have a lot that we don't. We actually have data in these as well. We don't have data to fill them, but we wanted to sort of set up the system, the shell, to be there. And we actually have data in some of these. And then the last thing is developing this 3D web GIS tool, okay? To bring together the GIS and the 3D. So what I want to do is show you, from those original goals, I want to show you some of the tools that we have. And I have to say that some of them are still, they're ongoing. We're continuing to work on these, right? There's not like after 3 years, ta-da. But we are continuing, and we're actually going to put in for 2 more years of funding for an extended grant to the BMDF in November next month. So I wanted to just show you a couple tools that came out of it. So this first one is not really geared towards researchers at all, but it comes out of that initial workshop thinking about the educators, right, and the needs, particularly in Honduras. And so what we did was we created a virtual tour that the park can use at in the visitor center there, but also online for schools as well. And what it does is you have to start here. It brings up sort of a screen, and all of our screens, we really try to have information on how to use this stuff. There's two ways to look at this. There's a suggested route that you can take here. So this guides the people through the tour. And sort of tell the story as you go through. But you also can have free exploration. We have a map over here. So the way this works is this is built off of 360-degree cameras. So you can turn around, look up. So this is what's here at the site today, and navigate around. You can click on these, quote, hotspots and see information about it. So this is in the hall. And there's information about this. Some of these also have sound. Also have sound embedded to give a sense of this. In addition to sort of zooming around and navigating in an orbital kind of fashion, you can also zoom in to certain features and see. So you can get a feel for what the site looks like today. This is just sculptural elements that you don't know the provenience for, but they're placed along the stockway, the road entering in. So from this point, then you can go to the map, or you can click on an arrow. I'm just going to pick another one here, and it takes you to another spot, or you can sort of use the arrow to kind of feel as if you're moving in the space. And you can go, you can examine each of these spots, pull up information about various features. We've also embedded in here, and we're continuing to do this, links to 3D models. So we have a stela here. You can zoom in to see this somewhat at this position up here. Stela A. And then what you can do is actually, it links to a 3D model. Now the quality of this, we're still trying to work on because we're bringing it over the internet. And so we have to sort of decimate a lot of the polygons in the sense of making the geometry not quite as accurate in order to convey this across the internet. But it worked rather quickly, and we've managed to keep a lot of that. And I'll speak a little bit more to that in a minute. So this is one tool that we created. It wasn't necessarily meant for scholars, but it sort of, we're collecting this data and we imparted it for educational and to promote the site of Copan. So in addition to that, what we've also created is a 3D single object view. Okay, so you can come into the website, this is active online, and we have two sample data sets, sample 18, which Jennifer, the Washburine colleague of mine, as well as a graduate student at U of Bonn, is working on understanding and reconstructing this temple and taking using the archaeological data, the archival record, as well as 3D scans of this. So I'm going to go ahead and play a movie. This does work pretty quickly, but I think I'm just going to go back and go through and go ahead and show you, talk through this. And once you do that, you're getting your edge detection, we have a screenshot out as well. And you can kind of go through and kind of use this as a tool to kind of understand sort of where the edges might be based off of the geometry in the 3D model and rotate it. You also have the ability to call it up, underline it, to get some feel for perhaps the integrity of the model underneath, which may or may not have been decimated. In addition, you can change the background color, like I said, so if you want to use this for an illustrative purpose, you can then change that and work with it as well. So I'm going to switch over from this individual kind of object over, and there's the last, you also can carry out measurements with this online. So if you can look here, you can see that distance here is 1.61 meters, so it's quite much larger than you might anticipate just seeing a single object without a scale in the In addition to the single object, sort of thinking about architectural sculpture and individual elements that have been the reality of what exists today, we also, you can put in hypothetical reconstructions. So this is Mike Lyons, he's the master student at U of Bonn. And what he's been doing is taking all of the data and trying to figure out where the architectural sculpture and what the building might have looked like. But within the system, what we've done, which I think makes it quite unique and different than perhaps other 3D viewers, is it's actively linked to the database. So when you have segmented objects, for example, individual glyphs within a motif, and you click on it, it will then tell you what kind of motif that is, actively the information that is within in the system. In addition, you can change, you can see underneath in this set. This is a tomb that is underneath this temple. And as well, you can click on the tomb, and then these are all of the information that are stored in the database that's affiliated with that. So you can move around, interact, and pick up and pull out this individual data that's actively attached to the database. So we have talked about the virtual tour, which is kind of oriented to the public, the 3D object viewer, which allows you to look at different types of objects, but in a singular fashion, right? They're not embedded in a landscape. They're in and of themselves. So really where a lot of this originally came from when Jennifer and I started the project, really 6 years ago now, I guess, was we were really trying to focus on this idea of the 3D web GIS. Originally, in the first pilot project, what I showed you was we developed a 3D web GIS that allows you to navigate through Copan and click on elements linked to the database. But we decided, and after talking to colleagues, that perhaps we ought to step back a second and actually provide another kind of portal, another kind of entranceway that's more familiar to people, something that was more like Google Maps or something like this. So what we did is we developed an open source 2D georouter, which is created from something called GeoMajas, which uses JavaScript. And it, you can use as an underlying, it interactively zooms in and out, just like Google Maps. In fact, you can use Google Maps as the underlying map system if you'd like. We've used OpenStreet Maps, so, but you can interchange that. And what you're seeing here is, I mean, it extends out to the entire world. It's a 2D geo browser of the world. However, we focus primarily on the Maya region, given our interest. And what you can see here are these are 6,000 Maya sites that we were able to get data generously given to us through the electronic Maya Atlas project out of Longwood University and Jordan Atlantic University. And then what you're seeing here, though, also are these red sites. Okay, these are the archaeological parks. So we have this major issue that we have a lot to deal with in archaeology, which makes it difficult sometimes, is we have data sensitivity, right? We can't show everybody in this geo-reference world exactly the precise location of these sites, or there could be loot. So what we've also done, and one reason we chose GeoMajas, is it allows you to create user-level access. So we have five levels of access in the system. We have a public one, which you would not have access to these blue sites. You would just see the red sites, which are the archaeological parks. You can click on those and obtain data that are in the database. There's also access, then there are other levels of access as well in here. So what you can see here is we have, you can click on the information. If you look up here, you can get the features from this. You can select features. If you have a certain level of access, you can also edit features via online as well. And then we have a layer tree here with different layers of data. Since we've been focusing on Copan, we have a quick zoom to Copan button to make our life easier. And there are different layers you can see here. This is a shape file of the core of the site overlaid on a terrain model, which is from LiDAR data, which I'll talk about in a minute. And then we have query functions built in. The moment we have six, we're trying to make it a much more flexible. We're not really happy with this. But one thing that we really have found a great thing that we're excited about is we've been able to create a time converter so that you can put in Gregorian dates and then return the Maya long count. And then you can query our database via Maya long count dates within a certain range that you may or may not know, but through Gregorian dates. Because stored within the database, we often have things like the Maya long count dates, and they're not been translated yet into a standard Gregorian date. So, in addition to having this 2D browser, if you go into the website, which I'm not going to do a live demo right now, the internet seems great here and probably we hope, but there are these four tabs you can see at the top here. The 2D geo browser, that's sort of the entrance portal. Then you can click on the 3D geo browser. And so what this it's allowing you to sort of translate that in the middle area where you saw that shape file, that is basically the footprints of the building, into 3D. So this is a 3D environment that's now linked to the database, just as that shape file was. So you can click on individual objects and pull up the data, and it's actively linking to the database, which is a PostgreSQL open source database with a PostGIS extension. Throw that out for the details. But what you can do is then also link on these and then pull up an image database. We have images for many of these as well. So when you click on the object, you can resize the window and look at it adjacent to it, zoom into the feature. But you can pull up the various photographs or drawings or maps, whatever you may have, that are affiliated with that. In addition, we've taken it out of this final version at the moment, the current prototype version. You also, remember the 3D object viewer? You could also link to that via this environment as well. So the infrastructure exists, but the current version does not have it, so we're working on some quirks with that. So you have this kind of environment that you can zoom through, click on, in lieu of, for example, Google Maps. So what I want to do now is return to talking about why, right? The research behind all of this. What is the utility of potentially going to the 3D environment instead of the 2D? So if we return to this issue, we'll focus on visibility. In a traditional GIS environment, we do typically what's called a viewshed analysis, right? We're working with raster data, pixel data, to quantify the percentage of visible or non-visible areas in some sense. So over here, what you're seeing is that from this group here, the yellow dot, everywhere in pink, if you were standing at that location, right, you would be able to then see all of the places in pink, okay, but not here. So it's suggesting that these visual ties with the hillsides, where there's not much settlement, but really you don't have much of a relationship with actually the settlement within the city, right? And And then here you have another scenario in which there's a lot of pink down here suggesting that there's quite a bit of visibility interconnection between a lot of the settlement in the valley. So this is great, right? And I took this my dissertation, did it for, you know, many sites, statistical analyses, et cetera, and I was able to quantify it all. And so I was able to see patterns that we hadn't seen before between site types. I'm not going to go into all of that. But I still felt, okay, I want to understand the experience and what this then translates into human life, right? And I just the 2D isn't giving me that. And also, in some sense, there are errors within the data because of the raster footprints. For that too much. So what I did was I sat down with Michael Auer, who's really our development specialist, for the 3D web GIS. He's incredible. And we sat down and we said, how do we translate what we know about data types in GIS, and particularly visibility that we're typically doing with raster data, into a non-raster environment, into a 3D environment? What is it, what do we need? What kind of tools? So we just sat down and kind of made basic sketches here. Really, we want like a line of sight tool, right? Kind of simple. We also have that in GIS. Just from a point to other known points, what you can, who can see what. And then we wanted something like a view shift, but we don't have pixel data, we don't have surface data, right? But so we thought, well, perhaps what we could do is kind of create a grid of points, and then at each of those points, do this line of sight back and forth. So the size of your grid and the number of points will influence the accuracy of your returns. And then a point on path. So if you have a path through the landscape, what can you see? And these come out of, so we thought, okay, so let's go ahead and start to think about how they might play in research-specific research questions. So at Copan, there are 7 valley stela spread out throughout the valley. And there's always been sort of this question about, well, why? Up until ruler 12, there's a dynastic, there's a history of 16 rulers at Copan. The first 11 mostly had their stela, these long sort of stones, carved stones, placed in the center. Why did Ruler 12 suddenly place them all over the valley? I mean, he has some in the center too. So there are different hypotheses about this. One, by Solanus Morley in the 1920s, was that at least some of them may have been sun markers. So you would have stood here and seen the sun here, and the sun would have been setting or rising on April 12th. And this is the onset of the planting season. So it would have suggested this. Another other colleagues have suggested that it was territorial markers. This is the time of great expansion of the polity beyond this valley area, which covers about 25 square kilometers. Someone else has said, well, it's a line of sight communication. So they would light smoke signals, right, if someone was coming or worried it was a time of warfare. And then something that I came up independently with, and also another person did independently, which I hadn't realized until recently, is published from Brown. Looking at another source of data, is that potentially there actually stops along a ritual procession route. And I'll sort of talk a bit about how that came to be. And Carter, Nick Carter, who wrote this paper at Brown, looked at specifically at the iconography. And sort of came up with this independently, this same argument. So how do we begin to sort of look at these individual kinds of hypotheses in this 3D GIS system, right, that we couldn't do otherwise? Well, in the case of the stela 10 and stela 12 as sun markers, we can sort of begin to address the beginning part of that question. We're in this 3D environment. The data for the landscape is quite accurately acquired from LIDAR, airborne LIDAR data. And we also went out on the landscape and we got precise coordinate information using differential GPS for each of the stela, remeasured their heights, et cetera, so we have quite accurate data. And so what we can do with just in the system online relatively quickly, there's a function of line of sight. You click on one point, you click on another, and it tells you, is that object target visible or not? Very simple, similar to if you use ArcGIS or not. Very similar kind of functionality. And so why not just do this in ArcGIS? Right? I mean, what's the difference, right? Well, in some sense, you're dealing with in ArcGIS that idea of that raster footprint. You can only get so accurate within that. Within this, we have the three actual true 3D models put in, and so it allows you to be more precise and specific. As for determining whether they're sun markers, We were thinking about instituting, Google has a sort of solar planetary kind of system that you could actually, we could link up to this so that you could actually look at the constellations and the setting sun at certain time periods that could be linked to this. But for the moment, what we're doing is testing it in an open source software called Stellarium, working with somebody in Vienna with these 3D models. So for another tool that we've begun to develop, is this intervisibility network tool. And what this allows us to do, is showing you working within the system, is that you can actually bring in data. So this is really important, right? Not only looking at this and like doing some kind of analysis, but being able to import and export any kind of stuff that you work with. And so you can bring in, it's called a GeoJSON file, but basically you can have a shapefile, you just convert it to this file quite easily. Something like quantum GIS, which is open source. You bring this in, and what you're seeing here, these are the stele locations brought in, and we've brought them in. And now what we want to do is run an intervisibility analysis to see which stele could see each other and relate to each other, which direction they were in. So there's a tool built into the 3D Web GIS. We've provided a sort of an information about how to use it, what it does, and the various parameters so that people kind of know what they're doing. You can then select targets on or off, right, for certain things, put in heights, and then you click to run it. And it's running quite quickly. Like, this is the video, but this is real time in the sense of the video. And you can see this is running through the internet across, dealing with these data. So it runs quite quickly. So that's boom. So now we have this intervisibility network that's run, that's been computed, and it's telling you between the different stela, which if you could see, if you're showing at stela 12, you can see stela 13, or can you see stela 8. Then that data can be brought back out and then analyzed further in more of a traditional GIS, perhaps. And so you bring it out, and this is brought into quantum. And there's various information embedded in here that tells you sort of the direction of the view, what you can see from spots all along that line of sight as well, where you can see, almost like a path, okay? So getting to that path, so along the way, where you can see where it can go. So to the third kind of analysis that we're embedding into the system, and this one's not totally done yet, but this is the one I'm most excited about, in some sense, is the points on a path. So for some of my research using traditional GIS, I basically was like, I wonder if there's, some kind of, I do a lot with accessibility, I wonder if there's sort of a least cost path and path between these different stela. So lo and behold, I ran between each of the stela to the main principal group and out, and pretty much the least cost path across the valley falls along these stela, which is quite interesting. I was like, that's kind of cool. Right? So, but I want to be able to take this further, right? I want to be able to sort of not just say, okay, but how do I understand how that might have, what the journey along that might have been along the way? And you can do that, sure, in this flat GIS quantitative way. But you're getting returns of numbers and sort of flat areas. You're not seeing the aesthetics of it. You don't have sculpture. You can't bring in those elements. In addition, you're getting, in some sense, a false return based off of pixel size. So what we're doing now is the idea is you can, from the least cost path analysis, you can bring out, as that GeoJSON file that I showed you previously, you can incorporate that in at the point locations. You can then run all of those at those locations and bring them in here into the system. So we're still working on this here to begin to understand. So, just sort of, those are the three main kind of tools that we worked on, that we've been developing, and we continue to develop to answer questions and look at questions in ways that can't really do with a traditional GIS. So, that said, not to seem ungrateful, I'm still sort of, there's elements that are just still shortcoming, right? I mean, we're going to continue to build on those and continue to work on those. But there's definitely some shortcomings to those and limitations. Part of it is technological, but a lot of it is just time and money and expertise, too. It's a combination of both. So I've begun a second ancillary project that's affiliated with using a lot of the data that we collected from the Meyer Community Project, and the data that I'm creating will also feed back into that. the Maya City Builder Project. Okay, so one thing that I'm really interested in addition to my research questions, right, on a broader level, right, and I think a lot of scholars are, is we want to be able to make complete reconstructions of ancient cities, right? But mostly, why do we want to do that? Well, they don't exist anymore, right? I mean, for the most part, right? We have this incomplete inventory, and we have different kinds of data that we're working with. Sometimes we have a partial reconstruction on site, other times we have an architectural plan. Sometimes, I mean, most of the time in my region, we just have an unexcavated mound. Right? So we need some way to be able to begin to create, to work with hypothetical reconstructions, right? So when you're using GIS, typically you're dealing with often data that in some extent sense exists, right? In some way. It's not easy to create a hypothetical model from GIS data, or maybe it is with using something called procedural modeling. what I've been working on is turning to something called procedural modeling as a way to begin to create alternative reconstructions of this landscape. Because if I want to go in and I want to look at the accessibility and visibility along these routes, what is the degree of certainty I have of the reconstructions along the way? Right? How do I interchange those? How do I bring in those different data? I don't want to just have popped up extruded schematic blocks, right? I want the aesthetics of the experience of the people, they didn't live in a blocky world, right? I mean, there's more to it. So to get at that, I need to bring in some more of these models. So what procedural modeling allows you to do is rapidly prototype 3D models from a set of rules, okay? And it can do this from a variety of sources. And it links that to the underlying data. In this case, I'm using City Engine, which does it through GIS. So I'm making use of my GIS data that I've created, this georeference data, but within this system called City Engine, which has actually been bought by Esri. So Esri runs ArcGIS, which is basically the Microsoft of the GIS world. Many federal and state agencies do this, ubiquitous. City Engine was created in 2001 out of ETH Zurich, the University of Zurich, by Pascal Mueller. And what he was trying to do was figure out how to sort of incorporate flexibility within the GIS, but in a 3D way. So he developed a coding language called CGA, Computer Graphic Architecture. And what you can do is use a set of rules. So you start out with your footprint from the GIS, right? But instead of having this flat, static kind of thing, you apply rules based off of what you know about the architecture. So within my architecture, we know they have platforms, okay? We have stairs, right? We have a lower facade, a medial molding, an upper facade. And you can begin to play around with these in proportion to this. You can put mathematical models in, you can link to your database. And the beauty of this is you don't necessarily have to have your data in your field. So you don't have to say, encode every single footprint. I have over 3,000 buildings I'm working with at Hopon trying to reconstruct. I don't have to say, this building has 5 stairs. This building has 6 stairs. This building, because I just need to have the attribute of stairs. And then I can put a rule in, and it creates it for me in the spot. So that gives me that flexibility, okay, to do that. So this is where I've been turning. And some of the reasons I've turned to this are these three main challenges. One is mapping sites across the canopy landscape, right? Not all the world is open and barren. in fact, most of the Maya region is covered with thick semi-tropical. And so how do you map archaeological sites? How do you do landscape archaeology? How do you understand the relationships between city centers and suburbs and peripheries if you don't know what's out there, right? Second, Maya cities are not orthogonal, right? They're not gridded. They're not Western kind of cities in the sense that we think of maybe more Western kind of cities. So how do you begin to populate those? And then, how do you begin to change and interchange models in and out to test your hypotheses? without being having a fixed representation. So for challenge one, mapping site, this is what the landscape looks like at Copan. So you can imagine the difficulty of actually mapping this landscape. So what we've done, and I referred to it a couple times during the talk, is we were able to get a grant from the Goethe Henkel Foundation out of Germany to fly airborne LiDAR data. So basically what this does is from the airplane has a scanner, which shoots down a laser, and the laser basically more or less can, based off of the time of flight, and what hits, it comes back in the general sense, can create and pick up, penetrate the canopy, so to speak, and allow us to see what's below it. So what you're looking at here is, this is LiDAR data. This is a bunch of 3D point clouds. This is not an image, this is just a bunch of 3D clouds, and this is what we call the first return, the first hit. So this is what you're seeing. However, with post-processing of these data, what we can do is begin to reveal what's underneath, okay? And so now you can see beneath all of that vegetation, what we have here, this is the core of the site at Copan, this is the main ceremony. You can begin to see the reconstructed architecture in comparison to these mounds, right? But now we've done this for 25 square kilometers across the valley, so now we can map the locations of these sites. Fantastic. So we can have a more accurate GIS map of those. But how do we then begin to populate those with 3D architecture, right? Well, there's a few different strategies. One is use architectural plans that are in existence. So for example, up here on the left, what you see is part of a map from was created by photogrammetric methods by two Austrian architects in the 80s. And I went through and hand digitized all of these, took the maps, and figured out all of the heights of all of the steps and all of these things. That's for my dissertation, in addition to a long topographical. I had a brace on at one point. So you can take that and you can extrude that relatively quickly and relatively easily and get something fairly accurate without the, as we talked before, the blocky and chunky, right? But most of your data does not look like that. That's not mostly what you're dealing with. We don't have these nice maps. Mostly this is what we have here out on the landscape, these unexcavated mounds. This is a structure. You have a person here for scale. Okay, some of them are much smaller, some are much larger. How do I go from this to some kind of reconstruction? Can I even do that? Should I even do that? You know? We have data in our database that suggests coded certain site types based off of surveys. We have test bits across the region we've linked to it. So we have some idea of things, okay, from data. So the way I originally began to do this was using SketchUp, okay, 2010, 2011. I had a postdoc at the home lab in Umeå, Sweden. And the home lab brings together culture and IT. It's a fantastic place. And so I was working on trying to visualize some of this architecture. And at the time, I chose to use SketchUp. And I'm doing this manually, and this is taking forever. And so I was like, okay, well, you know what? We have these five site types. I'm going to go ahead and create these templates, okay? And these are kind of the five basic templates. But even then, with these templates, you still have to go in and manually size them and scale them, et cetera, to the footprints. And then you're making all these decisions, at least I was, going, wait. And how am I recording the decisions I made, right? The paradata, my interpretive data. I mean, I can write them down somewhere, but they're not linked to it. Nobody knows. I'm like, yeah, that's good. You know, I mean, not quite like that, but okay. And even after all the time of being there, I was able to do 800 structures, okay? And this is the result of it. But there's still 2,500 structures not done, okay? And this was just, I was like, there's gotta be a better way to do this, okay? This is just too time consuming, you know? And also, in the end, I still have a fixed representation, right? I can't interchange anything. I don't have my decisions linked to it. It's not really dynamic. So in the sense of, these are the extruded, what we call level of detail one, and this is then replaced in the system that you saw on the WebGIS with the SketchUp models. So you can see the difference here, we have actual like peak roofs here, right? Versus square roofs in some of the houses up here, right? And thinking about visibility analysis, that's important, right? Thinking about those kind of differences. So how do we begin to get away from these challenges, right? This fixed representation. So So this is just a workflow of the Maya City Building project. So the first thing I sat down this year's new project is I'm very excited to create a workflow. Okay, what are the elements that go into this? It's divided into three main parts. So we have the archaeological, the archival 2D data, which is integral to this analysis, right? Using digital tools, using 3D, doesn't mean you forego all of this, all of the photos, all of this other stuff. This is critical information that goes into creating these models. We need those. We also have the reality-based architecture, right? The photogrammetry, the laser scans, what is there, what's in existence, okay? So we have these two data sets that we're working with here. And so here are just some examples of those. We have this GIS data, it's footprints across, and like I said, there's over 3,500 structures in the GIS across the valley. We have some of the SketchUp models created. We have a couple of 3D Studio Max models, one is 22 and then 18, the other one I showed you. In addition, we have some reality-based data. This is from the photogrammetry, and this is laser scan. So we have this various architectural input, different sources, different data scales, different things. How can we bring these all together and make use of them in some way, okay? Second, we have to get terrain. I'm not interested in isolated individual objects in and of themselves. I'm interested in their larger context. So we need the terrain, okay? So this is the terrain input. This is from the LiDAR data showing the terrain here. So how do we then begin to bring these two together so that our architecture that we're trying to represent across the landscape and then test hypothetical models, how do we bring those two together? Well, as I mentioned before, using City Engine, it's a GIS-based system, right? So it has locational precision, locational accuracy. You can bring in data layers, you can bring in terrain, and you can bring in those different models and types within that, and then begin to play around and test it. So what you're seeing here is, on the right, basically, this is linked to the database, basically the GIS shapefile. These are the attributes, right? You can see they're the kind of think about a spreadsheet in Excel, right? And what you can do is just change and play around with these things via code, and within the span of maybe a week or two of writing this code, what it took me 2 years to do 800, I was able to do in populate 3,500 buildings. Okay, it's not perfect, you can see some glitches. The rules, I'm not gonna talk about the individual challenges, it's presented on those in Granada and published a paper on those if you're really interested in the bioarchitecture and individual nuances of difficulties of using procedural modeling. But what you can see is that this really is allowing this flexibility and it's linked to these data. And the beauty of it is there's these rules that come out. There's a schematic, hierarchical schematic you can bring out that shows the relationships, but you can write comments, but the paradata, the decisions you've made are embedded in what you've done. So it's already there, which is great. It's not a visually, graphically fantastic way to do it, which this still question is still a lot of work to be done on. But at least it's encoding inherently, in some sense, the metadata. So in the end, the city engine, what you're able to do is take this terrain, which is georeferenced, bring in different kinds of data. Here we have the SketchUp data, here we have the CAD data, and then out here, I don't have it embedded in here, but we have the data from the procedural modeling in of itself. And you can test different scenarios within a certain environment. So one thing, sort of speaking of talking about the paradata and these decisions about modeling, and something that's very up in the air still, is how do we reflect uncertainty in a graphic way? Is that the way to do it? There's just at a panel discussion, and sort of that was one of the key things, is someone from Colonial Williamsburg was saying they've been grappling with representing uncertainty in their architectural reconstructions of Williamsburg, right? And he's like, I'm not sure graphical is the best way to do it. He's not, is it or is it not? I don't know. There's various ways to do it, right? We have the stoplight system and things like that. I don't know, I'm in the early stages. I feel like procedural modeling might provide some way, because of the embeddedness, to sort of combine the two. I'm not sure, just thinking about it. So uncertainty, I think that's something that we should be thinking about in doing our models and reflecting on when we're doing reconstruction. The other thing is while City Engine is proprietary, and I'm very much open source, and my 3D project is completely focused on open source, I'm taking advantage of the system. You can export out into various forms. right? So it is interchangeable, interoperable in a sense, which is advantageous. It's not sort of this, it might be a black box in some sense, but it at least allows you to take the fruits of your labor and use them elsewhere, okay? And so what we've begun to do is, in the last part of the Maya City Builder project, is to begin to render these things, right? To be able to bring them into a 3D environment and in a more sort of palatable way. And so I was talking about, these are just some, we've just been working on this semester a little bit. And this is something Zachary Day, who I believe got his undergrad in anthropology here, is working on. He's a grad student. And he's been doing some reconstruction. So you can see we've been playing around with some of the different resolutions of the terrain, trying to deal with heavy models, light models, what you get, what you don't. Please don't look at the texture, but I think that's... but what you're seeing is beginning to put this kind of in a more realistic kind of environment, okay? You exported that out. And to give you just a sense of that. Before I wrap up here. So what you can see here, this is in Unity 3D, which is a gaming platform. So you can take the data from City Engine, you can take your LiDAR data that you can take your models from SketchUp. You can take your reality-based models from photogrammetry or laser scanning and use them as OBJs or other formats. Blah. Bring them in into one environment and then begin to test and play around and then export those out. And then, for example, we're showing this in Unity, which Unreal Engine is another one, which works perhaps has a better or higher quality and a faster engine, but Unity is a lot less expensive and easier to use in some ways. So this is what we're using for the moment right now. So you can move through the landscape and get a sense of this. And right now you're seeing the video, and these are untextured instructions. But you can begin to see this, and we can interchange some of these out and create alternative environments based off of our hypotheses, okay? And through doing this. And some of you, I'm not sure, Phil had mentioned too, that James Coltrane, had come a couple years ago and spoke at the forum. And he is a history assistant professor at UNL, and he's been working to develop a tool called Atomic 3D based off of Unity, which allows you, it links directly to a database, MySQL database, but also do annotations. So this then becomes a tool in which you can comment on back and forth. Scholars can begin to comment on reconstructions. So to wrap it up and bring it back to sort of this idea of these the seven steel and the valley, why did I turn, for that specific reason, why did I turn to procedural modeling? I don't feel that if I'm going to go through and look at the landscape and try to understand experiences along this potential route and the importance of different locations, I think one fixed representation isn't going to suffice to do that. I need to be able to create relatively quickly alternative scenarios and be able to record the decisions I've made in those and be able to, in some way, convey those decisions. So beyond the individual focus of looking at research questions and looking at visibility, and one of those questions is this possible procession route, on order to establish core periphery relationships, is the Maya City Builder. So we've begun to build a website for this. And our larger goals are much larger than that. The idea is to basically create a procedural modeling kit with rules that other Mayans can use. So Copan is a site that we're using as a test case. But to be able to use procedural modeling and so that others can apply it to their sites elsewhere in the Maya region. They don't have to reinvent the wheel. There's a Marie Saldana out of UCLA, North Carolina, worked with Chris Johansson on developing a Roman rule set. Okay? So thinking about something similar in a sense. But in addition to that, having a repository or database that stores both the 2D data and the 3D models, right? The OBJ or PLY, so people can have those and reuse them, whether it's in SketchUp or whether it's in 3D Studio Max, or ideally, which we've been working on, is combining what we've done in the Maya Art 3D project with an open source WebGL application that allows people to bring in their own terrain models, right, with G, geo-reference maps that they have of their site, and then begin to play around, almost like Legos, I suppose, in a sense, of the reconstructions at their own site, but from definitive Maya roots, okay? And then the last thing to think about with this is basically, is almost in reverse. So this, using procedural modeling, presupposes that you have a set of rules that you met. But what is keeping us from working backwards and trying to understand rules that aren't written down from the Maya to say, hey, we're seeing these patterns just like we do in GIS, but in a 3D way. We're beginning to see patterns potentially across sites or within a site or different time periods that begins us to then decipher what architectural rules the Maya may have had. Right? Does that make sense? So working backwards. So using that in a research tool in the back, in the back way. So, that was quite a bit. So, but just sort of to give you an idea of sort of some of the things that we've been working on and where it's been leading, some of the results, and all of it is continuing and ongoing. So, thank you. Well, it's interesting that you've asked that. I kind of did it from the reverse perspective, and I actually did, actually for my dissertation research, I used GIS to sort of devise an accessibility model, which I took least cost path analysis, and I basically averaged out between different site types. So we know we have, in the GIS, we have site types 1 through 5, and they reflect, 1 and 2 reflect, we believe, commoner households, non-elite. 3 and 4 would be elite households, and so you move up the chain. 1 would be the least elaborate household, maybe a single house or 2. A type 2 would still be non-elite, but a little more elaborate, more complex. At 3, etc., moving up. And we get to 5, it's the civic ceremonial center. So what I did was, I did from each building location to every other location on the site, or a group. There are 600 of them, I calculated the cost to travel across the surface using terrain and then using a different kind based on the hydrology. We have these quebradas, these arroyos, so in the river, so increasing cost to travel across those areas. So people aren't traveling through the rivers, which naturally the GIS would make them do. Incorporating different kinds of levels. And so from that, what I found, and I did statistical analysis between those, and what I found was fascinating is, yes, the type 1s, which you would expect, turn out to be the most isolated, least restricted, most difficult places to get to. The type 4s tend to be located in almost like, as if they're in control points, control access points. The same reflects in the visibility. They're the most visible, right? And the type 1s are the least visible. But the type 2s and 3s, which all along what we've considered in this typology, which is based on Harvard typology for the site, we've presupposed this division, economic, social structure division that suggests who might interact with whom based on 2s would be commoners and 3s would be elite. But both in the accessibility, the interaction, these connectivity values, as I call them, in a publication that I did in the Journal of Archaeological Research with with a colleague of mine, Kristen Landau, that both those and the visibility, what we have is 2s and 3s are very similar to each other. So which you wouldn't expect. Given the way we talk about social structure at the site, the way people should be doing things, they should be distinct groups, and they're not. They clump together. So part of continuing the analysis is to continue to explore, wait, is that typology useful? Is based solely on certain criteria? Can we develop new criteria? Right, and even in the GIS analysis, speaking of it, there is none of the experiential in those analyses that I did, right? There is none of the sculpture, all of those kinds of things aren't embedded and encoded, how they may have impacted the accessibility across the landscape. So we haven't devised any new approaches to that. It was something that I wanted to build into the system, but given the time and everything, we tended to focus on the visibility for now. Well, if you're going to be, so when I originally doing visibility analysis in a 2D GIS environment, you can sort of change the height by changing the attribute of the building, right? Mm-hmm. And then rerun it. But you're not getting, the roof pitch. You're not getting the angles, right? And I kind of think about it as not a, it's a tool to take you to the next step. Right, so the GIS might serve as one way to narrow down the areas to look or the pattern, for example, like the route. But then in order to be able to get at the experience, you then need to go in and begin to be able and then start to model those local places, right? In a 3D way, if I'm interested in the activities, you know, primarily it comes out I'm interested in procession routes, and there are three different types in the Maya region that we know of through ethnographic and other data sources, archaeological and depictions on walls. And I'm interested in this perhaps it being a more periphery kind of way to establish the ruler, to establish relationships with the periphery, right? And so which would make sense with ruler 12, the polity's growing, there's more warfare, he puts these out there, perhaps this is part of a way to also keep cohesion within the valley, right? You go out as part of the valley. So being able to sort of change out those representations and sort of say, this is what I'm thinking based off the data we have in this area, and then really it's the idea is that it would be more of a collaborative sense. This is mine, this is my reasons why. I can send it to a colleague and she can say, or he can say, wait, I don't know if I really agree with that or not, right? Based off of being able to look at that interpretation and move around, but be able to have that whole landscape perspective, not just a singular, this is my reconstruction, but from all of those angles, right? And understand that. And then, okay, so maybe that structure had three floors. Okay, rather than two. How does that then, we rerun the analysis of visibility, how does that play in, how does that affect? Does that mean that that building then becomes much larger, much more iconic, which is what Jennifer figured out for this temple that she was looking at the site. Originally, it was believed to have one floor, and then she went into the construction, she's arguing it's three, which completely changes its visibility on the landscape for time, and its potential impact, things like that. Yeah.
What would you consider as the best approach to construct an interface between the technological side of this and what seems to be a more phenomenological side that you haven't addressed much of?
Right, so the interface to do that?
Yes.
Well, that's what we would like to work on to develop, right? I'm not sure exactly of what, that's where I want to take this. I don't have an answer yet, per se, but I think to get to the more phenomenological side of it, you need to have the flexibility and not just the static model. So that's where, you know, right now we can do, in Unity, we can bring out these data, we can show them, and we can create the data in the procedural modeling environment relatively quickly, more or less. I mean, we're still working on dealing with the rules, and export those out and show another environment. But we're not able to do that in that environment of Unity, right, to be able to bring those in, link to the data. We don't have this nice ability to sort of test and play in there in that phenomenological way, right? And even, we haven't talked about plants, right? Which I have a whole other sub-project doing with plants, but I'm not gonna go into that, because that affects things. So, this is, you know, that's a difficult question. I don't know, it's the same way with the uncertainty one, how do you convey it graphically? Is this kind of an interface, the gaming interface, is that the best interface to do it or not? What I've been experimenting with in addition to this is using Oculus Rift, do the head-mounted gear that Facebook bought, I think last year or the year before, for $2 billion, and they're hoping to sort of completely revolutionized the way we interact with the internet, with the internet through this. So it's a head, for those of you who don't know, they're head-mounted, as a head-mounted glasses, basically, but kind of a little more cumbersome than that. And you put them on. Has anyone used Oculus Rift before? Okay, yeah, and it's amazing. Like, you feel like you're there, depending on the quality. So this may allow you somewhat to bring in the more phenomenological aspects within that environment, right? To be able to, you feel like you're actually more truly immersed and not separated, right, through that experience. So maybe that's another level. And so we've been playing around with that just for the coding sense. And so in this environment that you saw there, you can also walk through it with the headset. You can bring it, you can also walk through the site that way. We haven't linked it up to the database current or any of that information. That's our next step, as well as to bring in things that are real, that are more indicative than what you saw there. So I don't know if that answers it, but I think that I don't have an answer. I mean, that's something that I think is extremely important, and I think there's various ways to approach it. And it may also depend somewhat on individual researchers and how, you know, in some sense, but it's a field for development, I would say. And I think it's important to bring the two together. I mean, that's the whole point of this, really, in a sense, right? I mean, that's the whole idea. And I feel like, in some sense, we spent so much time in the Maya 3D project on developing the underlying open source infrastructure, which was fantastic and great and wonderful. But somehow the aesthetics still got missing. They're still missing. So I'm trying to figure out how to bring that back into it, right? And right now I'm having to rely on proprietary software because it's the fastest, it's the best. It works with beta that I'm familiar with GIS. So, but in the end, it's to extrapolate that into something that kind of gets to where Jennifer and I's really our end goal really was, which we haven't, you know, probably need to work on forever. But does that make sense? Somewhat? Okay. It wasn't fluid, it wasn't, it was literally you're here and then you're there and you're individual. There's no fluidity between that. You can't do that in one single environment in the wire 3D tool. So I see the value of all of them. I think they're important, and I think that that is some way to reflect just the certainty or uncertainty in your reconstructions visually, if you can sort of bring in those different components, right? So, you know, we often have our drawings, right? You showed the drawing before where you put a color code based off of what's known or not known, what's partially certain, right? But it'd be nice to have it be more interactive in the sense that you're not restricted only to that schematic block when you don't know something, but to be able to play around based off of what you do know. Right? So for example, all of those mounds that I am dealing with, I went through and I examined the ethnographic literature, got the average pitch of roofs based off of different types, what the material would have been. I went through all of the excavated sites, got the average platform, linked all of that up, and that's all the data behind this, and then I put in a trig function in the GIS to code that, and then extruded those. So there's a lot behind that that you don't see when you see that, right? And so, but should I have not done any of that, because I don't know? And I don't think so. I mean, that keeps us insightful. So I think that we should have the photo, but I also think that the photorealistic ones are not only important for the public, right, to intrigue them, because, you know, another discussion we just had at the meeting at panel discussion in Granada is from the point of view of younger students. They're like, you see this blocky kind of schematic thing, and we're gone. We're not even interested, right? So engaging the public in the future of our work as well. So, but I also think that in some sense, I don't know, it could be deceiving or it also could be helpful as scholars to be able to see that potential view, right? I don't know.
Right, and it also depends on the kinds of research questions that you're interested in.
True.
Like if you're interested in taking your procedural modeling projects and modeling or critiquing social interaction or gendered spaces or something like that, you don't necessarily need to show a bad truth.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
that's true. Yeah, it depends on, yeah, unless that had some sort of significance.
Right.
Yeah. No, that's true. So you wouldn't need to then texture. You're right. Yeah. So that yeah. So it does depend. I mean, I know that again, referring to the work out of UCLA and Chris Johansson, a lot of the work that they've done, even though they have sort of this gradation of fully textured reconstructions, he also presents a lot of his work, which he's actually interested in procession of, in a funerary procession, in schematic ways, because an argument that those are unnecessary things, so why spend the time on those? So, yeah, comes down to your objectives, your goals, and your questions as a researcher.
I had another question about the City Engine and the open source approach that you seem to be taking. Do you think this is going to, do you think that these tools will eventually make it possible for those of us who are dependent on Esri and ArcGIS mm-hmm. to say goodbye to the Microsoft of GIS?
I don't know. I mean, it depends. I mean, people have been trying that with quantum GIS,
yeah.
You know, and I like quantum for a certain degree of things, but I always go back to ArcGIS for basic things, even though because I'm quick, I'm at it, I'm fast at it, I know it. And, you know, it's what I learned. In terms of procedural modeling, I don't know. I mean, there's so much money, there's so much complexity. I mean, even now, like currently the version of City Engine allows you to bring in OBJs and PLYs, meshes, but not 3D point cloud, right? But actually City Engine already has devised through the money they have ways to bring in point clouds. They just haven't brought it out to the public yet, right? And so what I would like to do when that comes out is actually work backwards again in terms of creating individual segments of architecture and bring them out from reality-based models, not only from schematics. Does that make sense? Segmenting those models and taking advantage of the system that can segment it and bring it out. Because we spend hours and hours and weeks segmenting these 3D models in order to then link them up. But if we have a system and a way to do it for us to bring out, you know, it would be fantastic. So I don't know. I mean, maybe someday, sure. You know, I don't know. But I don't know. I advocate more, I guess, in the sense, is making and taking advantage of all the tools that you have at hand. So I use a suite of tools, and that's why I know, you know, we've been working to create open source tools and establish a collaborative thing. And a lot of that has been the Nerd Institute Anthropology is adopting that system and will be using it as a management system. Because up in, you know, when we went there in 2009, the only GIS they had was a spreadsheet and Excel spreadsheet. Site and XY locations. And now we have a lot more information. In fact, we had another student for her BA out of Bonn go through in all of the published literature and get and create the GIS for a lot of the other Honduran archaeologists. But as a researcher, I really need to take advantage. You know, I have two parts. One is developing digital tools, the other is doing my own research. So I'm going to use what's at hand and what I have available to do my own research. But simultaneously, I really think it's important to reuse these data, right, in some other way and make them available to others, whether it's the public, other researchers, whatever it might be. So it's kind of wearing two hats, but I don't think we'll get away from completely applying to the software. We just don't have the money to do what they can do at certain levels. So the idea, I think, is developing tools that allow us to do the key functionalities that maybe will suit larger amounts of researchers to a certain degree or allow it to do things that maybe the other systems can't, like the intervisibility network that we have, and then bring it back into the GIS, right? The focus on developing in the niches that are already existing.
Do you have any plans in place to deal with digital obsolescence?
It's funny that you asked that. I'm trying to work on that right now. In fact, I was at the NEH, had an advanced topics at Summer Institute of creating content this summer at UMass. It's actually a two-part, let's say, where we went to UMass, we all got together, we sort of came up with grand challenges, we learned about different kinds of software. Etc. We have a second part where we meet up at UCLA after we do a project, part of mine, which is the STELA one. But speaking to what you're asking about, yes, it's something that I'm very concerned with. So in fact, I've been working with CAST, Center for Advanced Spatial Technologies, out of Arkansas, working with them. They've been around for a very long time. They're fantastic, working with cultural heritage and 3D and GIS. Working with them on beginning to think about what kind of, you know, standards is a hard word to use, but best practices for 3D modeling or standards, trying to think about that. So working with them on this, which they have been involved to some extent as well with the Archaeological Data Service out of the UK as well and other things. But in addition to that, I actually had a Skype call on November 11th that finally got formalized between the 3D data archivalist, not 3D data archivalist, but 3D, I forgot her exact title. She was an archaeologist and then got her master's in library science, and she focuses a lot on 3D modeling and GIS. She's at Iowa. And then out of UC Berkeley, one of the art historian digital library there as well, and we're meeting with some of the librarians of the Love Library at UNL. We're all going to have a Skype conversation to begin to discuss this issue of dealing and beginning to think about how can we archive these data, not just to archive them, but to reuse them, right? So we're trying to bring in and think about these issues. I know Diane Farber from UCLA is also, does a lot with 3D reconstructions of urban simulations in the past and the present. Is as well as working on these issues. So dealing with the obsolescence, I think there are, people are working on trying to come up with 3D standards as well, not just, you know, around the world. The geographic, which of course should be open OGS, is working as well on a geographic standard, but 3D standards, right, per se. So this is an ongoing kind of, so the way to deal with the obsolescence is to keep abreast of what's currently going on, what people are using, and try and then work in groups to kind of be able to talk about those best practices and where to go with them, and that's what we're trying and we're doing as communities. So, you know, and when you're using certain formats, to be able to export them in a variety of formats for storage for now, right? Like OBJ or POI, just like we have a JPEG or a TIFF for archival, like 2Ds. At least at the moment. But yeah, I mean, a lot of this does become obsolete. I mean, for example, Unity, right? So our original, if you go onto Chrome, and if they're not using what's called WebGL, if you want to download automatically, the plugin Chrome will no longer support it. You would just get an error because of private, because of security issues. So things like that, and you thought, nobody thought, everything we're doing. So these things happen, yeah. And so we have to try to keep, and I think having conversations, you know, amongst different people and trying to, like I said, this word standards is hard, but best practices / standards, I don't know, right? Yeah.
Well, not just in the long term, but in the immediate sense, like how much data are you talking about, like terabytes, and where does it live? Just like
these data? Well, right now, the data are stored at the German Archaeological Institute. So the project moved from the University of New Mexico, where it started, to the German Archaeological Institute. And it is backed up by all of their servers. And it's also backed up, cross-backed up with Berkeley as well. So the German Archaeological Institute has an agreement, and so they're both mirroring each other some as well as that. In terms of the storage of the data, I'm trying to think about how much data are stored. That's a good question. I don't really know the answer to that, like offhand. I mean, but these data sets are very large. They're very, very large, you know, when you're dealing with the raw archival data, right? Because you've got raw archival data that you've collected. Should be archival, I don't know. But the raw, the data, the large data sets that you've collected, the 3D.5. But then you decimated them, turned them into a mesh, and you might have decimated them more for one environment on a desktop versus another online, right? So you have these different iterations of these models, right? And you also need the metadata stored with that, so you know how it's collected and what you did with it, right? So, yeah, it exponentially gets pretty large.
And you mentioned you're working with librarians, or is that just some people are working with?
Yeah, well, I'm starting to work with librarians on this, yeah. But, yeah, and as well. And so, just sort of, yeah, through the Love Library, which is at UNL and then Iowa and Berkeley.
For most of the large size files are landscape. Landscape stuff, right? The procedural models.
Procedural models
are pretty small, right? Those are just faceted. Polygons, not dealing with solid modeling.
Right.
It's just polygons, right?
Right. Procedural modeling is not very heavy.
That's a good practice because the polygonal structure has been around forever and will probably be around for a long time, as opposed to NURBS or these more mathematically based modeling.
Different types or different versions of the same or both?
It's more or less the same thing, but it's, you know, it was a multi-gen creator in the 90s, which was a Department of Defense flight simulation software. It was very handsome, and I worked for our students together, and we learned that, you know. And then it went from there to Maya, and then it went to something else. Now it's Rhino, now, or 3D Studio Max, whatever. And, you know, it's very frustrating because the models that you make with, you know, the models that we made in the early 2000s, some of them we're not even really able to open up and have the textures be correct because simply of the proprietary file formats that are not talking to each other. And I think that best practices is a really good subject to be talking about.
Yeah, I mean, I think in that sense, it's like formats that are open in a sense, right?
Yeah.
Open and not proprietary. And if you're using proprietary formats, like they or software, can they export out into something that's then usable? And then the question is, what do they preserve? What don't they preserve in terms of the original?
Right.
You know, stuff. But so that, like I said, that's sort of one of the reasons the City Engine is that it does allow this export into multiple formats. Otherwise. You know, and you know, we're trying to play with vegetation now, and exploring something called speed tree, which is a procedural modeling for plants. And you know, someone mentioned to me, I was like, "But can you export out? Can you?" And they're like, "I don't know." I'm like, "Well, if you can't export out, I'm like, I don't want to just create this pretty model in one place. But you can, I'm sure that you can. But like, we're still exploring. Like, that is key. It's important that it can be translated out into different formats, and some those that can go across. Like, Collada is a good one too.